something went on here, something went on there. And
this time on TNT,
we talk about all things tragically hip.
We workshop our new sitcom, Andrea and Them.
And we play a brand new game, Hobo or Nobo. That's all coming up right now on TNT.
73 times I've said hello to you on this show. How are you, bud?
I'm good. How are you, bud?
I'm good. Are you excited about 73?
I am, yeah. And it feels like we need to start by talking about Gord.
Yes.
Because, I mean, one of the things that we've embraced on this show is Canadianity. And I don't know that there's a band that better embodies the spirit of Canadianity than the Hip.
Yeah, no, I think hands down that's a fact.
I mean, so if somehow,
no doubting that for sure.
If somehow, though it's unlikely, you haven't heard the news, it was announced this week that Gord Downie has terminal brain cancer.
Yeah.
And there's really no way to sugarcoat that. That is the reality, and his doctor said, you know, it is treatable. He's had radiation and chemo, and
yeah, he was diagnosed originally back in December, I think, right? And that's been through chemotherapy and just a lot of work and processes and operation to take away the mast of the tumor, and just a terrible situation. They're going to tour this summer. They just announced the dates today. I just can't imagine how difficult it must be for Gord just to kind of get, go through chemotherapy. And I mean, that makes you so broken down and tired to do a tour and all of this stuff. I can't imagine how emotional it's going to be for the fans and for the band and for him and his family. It's just... It's awful, but it's a beautiful thing that they can get out and do shows, because that's what he's best at.
I mean, there are people that certainly know him way better than me. There are bigger fans of the Tragically Hip than me, but I don't know, man. I can't shake it. I'm sure it's that he's 52 and a father of four. You know, lots of people go through this every day in our country, but
yeah,
you think of his bandmates and you think of his children and you know, people that love the band. It just seems like here's another guy, not unlike John Candy, that people turn to feel better. You know, he lets people know that everything's going to be okay just by existing. And when you hear that one of your heroes is mortal, it's definitely a blow.
Yeah, I can't believe how many shocking losses we've had this year, and then news like this. It really has been a horrible run in music and entertainment and media, in terms of the heroes and the influential people that have been either passed on or gotten sick, or it's been a horrible few months. I can't believe this. It's more than just I don't know if it's that we're getting older and you just start seeing this happen just because you're gaining traction and understanding that people don't live forever, but it's just been so many different influential people that have had bad stuff.
I mean, if there is a silver lining about this case in particular, it's that, you know, the announcement was made in plenty of time for people to let him and the band know what they mean to everyone, you know? In the case of Bowie and Prince, people probably didn't get that chance. But how rock and roll is it to make that announcement and then say, we're still going out on the road, it's what I need to do? It sounds like they got together last weekend and rehearsed, and at the end of it, they were like, yep, we can do this. Mm-hmm. And that in and of itself is supremely powerful.
Yeah.
But man, if anyone ever underestimated the influence that band had on Canada or Canadianity, the past couple of days has cemented their status.
Yeah, I mean, they were already a classic band, and they were already cemented in this country's history. And that's something that people kind of don't understand, how important that is and how amazing that is to be accepted by your own as one of the favorites of all time. It just, it's one of the, I don't know, there's not too many people in history. Politicians and celebrities is one thing, but music kind of gets into people more. There's more of a connection, and the fact that they're kind of number one already for this country is pretty incredible.
And you don't have to travel very far to find shining examples of them being perfect gentlemen. I remember Michael Neal, who played in the Inbreds, has a new band, Tons, by the way, with Chris Murphy and, yeah, and Matt Murphy, supergroup, Canadianity Styles. He said when they were in the Inbreds, they got asked to open for the Hip, and it was a huge deal, but they didn't have much dough. And they'd come down in the morning, and the Hip had quietly paid for their hotel rooms. Like, just classy, helpful, supportive, didn't have to do it, but bodism,
oh, yeah,
for altruistic reasons.
Yeah, every time OLP played with the Hip or had the opportunity to grace the same stage, it was always a pleasure, and those guys were always so kind and welcoming, and I remember being a big fan of them as a kid, just as a drummer, and seeing them live. I saw them at the Forum, I think, like the Waltons opened up back in the late 80s, and that Road Apples album was huge for me. I used to play along with records all the time, and that was one of them. And I always told those guys that I kind of grew up listening to their music and playing it from a young age, and then to be able to share a stage with them is kind of always, it was a dream for me. So that was more than any other Canadian band. So they're that big in terms of influence and not just musicians, but people across the country. And it seems to be more, if you go more rural the place, it's even bigger. And that's huge. I mean, that's kind of what we're all about in terms of talking about what this country is and the traditions and the history of it and celebrating it.
Totally. But the thing that they did, it was so educated. It's a wonder that they reached as broad an audience as they did.
Yeah.
By, with the lyrics as educated as they were. I mean, most of the references are lost on me, but I was just reading an interview that Gord did with Joseph Boyden, who's an unbelievable Canadian author, great dude, mm-hmm, bud. And he asked Gord, like, why he thought the Hip resonated so much, and he said it's because the songs. Everyone in the band tries to serve the songs musically as good as they can. And when the news broke yesterday, your first reaction is, oh my God, poor guy, poor family, poor band family, poor tour family. And then you start to think of all the times that their songs were the soundtrack to something in your own life.
Yep.
Like old relationships or weekend camping trips or road trips, when you were down, when you were up. And they certainly have a big enough library that, you know, it really could be the soundtrack to your own life. And then you think of those people in your life who are obsessed with the Hip, and you think, like, what a blow it is to those people. But the important thing to remember is, it sounds like treatment has been going fairly well. It sounds like, although it's inevitable that it will come back at some point, at least right now, things are fairly under control. And what a luxury to have the chance to celebrate this guy and this band. And this tour is going to be spectacular.
Yeah. Yep. And there's two shows here in Toronto we're lucky enough to have at the ACC.
I know. How about the show in Kingston?
Yeah, that's the final
wrapping
show
up
of the
tour in Kingston. I mean, that would be unbelievable.
That's one thing about the Hip that I think is also very Canadian is there's an element of simplicity in the way they write music. The actual music, not melody and lyrics, was always kind of classic rock, strong, very kind of bare bones, but live sounding, you know, very raw.
Yeah.
And I guess the depth of Gord's lyrics, but also his intelligence to be very simple with melodies and stuff like that. It becomes so, kind of a soup of like very kind of I guess like technical, but at the same time very simple. And that's classic Canadian, you know, when you meet somebody and you're always kind of blown away by the conversation or the depth of the mentality of the person when you might perceive something different when you first meet them, you know what I mean? Like almost like there's just a more of a blue collar feeling with their music, but the beauty of that, the classic Canadian side of it, where no matter what you do for a living or how you do it, it has nothing to do with your thought process or your depth of mentality, you know what I mean? I kind of grew up with that as with my own family and my dad, and the fact that he worked at Sears in a warehouse, it had nothing to do with having a conversation and you know, his understanding of the world, right?
Right. And you would know better than anybody what it would take to make a relationship like that band last for 3 decades. And
yeah,
do you know the comic Harry Dupe? He's like a hippophile.
Okay.
You know, seen them an awful lot and knows the guys socially. And he said that they are so diplomatic that they put everything to a vote. And if 2 guys in the band want to do something and 3 guys don't, they'll just take it off the table.
Yeah.
Like things have to kind of be unanimous in order for it to proceed.
Close enough. Yeah. Democratically. Yeah, and
that must be one of the ways they've been able to stay. Some of my favorite Hip tunes are actually the simplest. I mean, Wheat Kings is a great example, or Scared. That was actually in the second Trailer Park movie.
Mm-hmm.
But we asked each other to pick, might not be the favorite Hip tune, but the one that's circulating around our brains today. What did you pick?
I picked one of my favorites would be from the self-titled jams. From Fully Completely is Fully Completely. And this one was always a good one live.
Yeah, sure was.
Always is a good one live. It's such a, I don't know, it just kind of reminds me of what I was talking about earlier. There's kind of a simple feel to it, but it's got all kinds of technical depth as well. You know what I mean?
The gray one.
It's amazing how fast they could they got when they first started. I remember like New Orleans is Sinking and all those songs, and they were kind of had a feel of a bar band, and when their videos were them in a bar, it kind of made perfect sense. But they got so massive so quick that they became also accepted and understood as an arena band, which is kind of, and like you said earlier, like they made that transition without a hiccup at all.
Well, almost every song has a moment where in an arena setting, there's an easy excuse for a huge explosion or lights or people kind of pogoing on the spot. Like, if you haven't seen them live, you really should try to get out and see a show this summer. It is incredible. They're a great live band.
What's your choice for Hip jammies?
Well, there, I mean, it's hard to pick just one.
No,
there are so many songs that have you know, stayed with me. Bob Cajun is one that I had in my head for most of the calendar year that it came out. For yeah. some reason, the one that I've had in my head for the last day was written, named after a little-known Canadian graphic novel, which kind of sums up exactly where they were coming from. And kind of has a meandering melody that the first time you hear it, you might not quite pick it up, but on the fifth listening, it's incredible. It's a good life if you don't weaken. So much intensity.
Yeah.
But then the chorus is like suddenly really upbeat and positive. Here comes. Do you know this jam?
Yeah, of course, for sure.
Here comes. Man, can't say enough good stuff about the Hip.
Yeah, you mentioned the way they did kind of a democratic union in a sense, and everything was kind of decided upon through the group. And I mean, that was definitely the blueprint that OLP kind of took. And I mean, we had the same where we split everything up and everybody had their own independent company that all kind of went under the umbrella from day one. And
you must have to. That must be the recipe for a lasting thing.
Yeah, it really made sense, and there's something to be said for five guys to stick together and thick and thin, and they've gone through tough times before, and for some reason they'd never, I'm sure they've had lows as a band where they felt like packing it in, but they didn't really, that low wasn't, would always kind of go away, and they would get back together, and nothing really got too far. And
I guess
happened.
At that level, like, do you still have bad shows? Can you still have a bad show in an
I'm
arena?
Sure.
Or by then you're so tight?
Yeah, no, I'm that's constant to the I guess the self giving perspective to the shows and trying to keep everything good. I mean, that's never stops.
Like, did you ever walk off stage in an arena and go, oh man, we sucked?
Oh, for sure. 100%.
Really?
Yeah, definitely.
Would the crowd have known, or you just felt?
No, it's a subtle difference, but the line becomes pretty, it's still there. I mean, there's always something glaring.
When we were doing
better, I guess, right?
When we were doing I can't even remember what Trailer Park thing it was. It might have been a special, Say Goodnight to the Bad Guys, maybe. I wrote a song about how J-Rock doesn't suck. He's just 100 years ahead of his time. And sampled Ahead by a Century. And,
yeah.
And Mike Clattenburg was pretty friendly with Gord and pushed it through. And you and I actually played it at our with the Flatliners.
Yeah, that
at
was
our TNT show in Toronto as part of Canadian Music Week. And I was pretty nervous. And Mike Smith, who plays Bubbles, actually produced it in his home studio. And it's Ahead by a Century isn't really a song that lends itself to a rap group.
Not at all, but it works
but
totally.
I like the spirit of J-Rock thinking he's just 100 years ahead of his time. And all he has to do is like just chill for 100 years and then he'll be huge because people don't get it. So the Hip came to visit us on set when we were shooting Say Goodnight to the Bad Guys. And Gord said, man, thank you so much for thinking of our song. I hadn't imagined it in that way, and it was really a thrill to hear it that way. Like, almost.
That's amazing.
So gracious and generous and kind, and I, you know, we should have been begging him or thanking him. And he's like, man, we really appreciate what you've done for us. Like, oh my God. But why don't we take a break on TNT 73, and we'll play some 2108 Bounce Whimmy now, J-Rock's track. using Ahead by Century just to take us to break. And then when we come back, you have some 73 jams teed up for us, right, Bob? Well,
it was a great year.
We'll get right into things. I was 1 year old. Here's 2108. Bounce with me now.
2108, y'all. That's when J-Rock's gonna pop, pop, pop. Where the 808's at? Bounce with me now, with me now, bounce. Bounce with me now, with me now, bounce. First thing, I control all the purse strings. My wallets are jam-packed with greenbacks of bursting. Next thing, no dress rehearsing. My joints go down smoother than the drinks I'm nursing. The worst thing is that the crowd ain't bouncing. Even with my boasting and fly mic announcing, they ain't responding. And let me tell you, B, would hurt the feelings of a less hard G. I don't get it. My lyrics are poetic. My energy up on stage is frenetic, kinetic. The vibe between me and T, the stage is set for something electric. But it's pathetic. They're just standing there, not waving their hands like they just don't care. They just don't care. So I went home and blazed. Closed my eyes and an alien took me away. Bounce with me now, with me now.
Fucking right, eh?
What the...
It's 1973. What is it? Stampeders, baby.
Oh, my lady. Oh, good one. I'm alone, you feel
your presence in the... Drummer singing it. Classic. Is it? Just crushing it in the video. Through the storm, I felt your fire, saw your light. Jon Snow looking mask.
Oh, my
lady.
Do you know what's funny?
What?
I love mask.
What?
I love the word mask.
Yeah, it is. Good.
And I use it a lot, and part of the reason that we started using it on TPB is because it didn't technically count as a swear word.
Yeah.
So you could get away with mask.
I like how it made the Urban Dictionary.
I know.
Credited. That's crazy.
I know. So I use MAFC all the time. Like, shout out to the MAFC with the trailer hitch on his Toyota Corolla.
Do you say it with the kids?
No.
Yeah. You don't want them throwing that out.
But I feel like it's become a word that means more than its origin. Like, oh, check out that MAFC. It's Obie's. There was this MAFC. It's Obie's in his slippers. Like, it's kind of a term of endearment.
For sure.
So I get a message
like in a
yesterday.
Shoe store, can I get an 8.5 in these masks?
Yeah. Well, I think, especially when you call things masks. What time does this mask land in Winnipeg? Like,
that's to the steward?
Yeah. I love that you're, in your example, it was a male steward.
Yeah.
From when's the 60s.
When's this mask land?
Yeah. Are they giving you some peanuts? Any more of these masks? Oh, sorry, I dropped a map.
Or if you're in the bathroom, like, careful, that map creaks.
Yeah. Yeah, careful, don't go in there, that map. For some reason, yeah, where's Brent? Oh, I dropped that map off at Foot Locker. That map is a Foot Locker looking at masks on sale. It's really funny to me. But I got a message yesterday from a guy that I used to work with years ago saying, you need to drop that mask stuff. It's so old and stale. It's so not funny.
What?
And I never understood TPB because it appeals to only the lowest common denominator, and those people find it funny, but nobody else does.
Yeah.
And it was like a, whoa, hey, whoa, Jesus, yeah,
like
guy.
How long has this been on this guy's chest?
Well, I mean, aside from the odd, like, hey, man, oh, hey, man, over the last 10, 12 years, this is the first, like, shots fired. And it wasn't
you're just hanging out, and all of a sudden, he's like, you know what? I'm sick of this shit.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like, hey, bud, come here for a second. Right in the face.
What
like,
happened?
Hey, does this smell like battery acid?
What happened?
Well, I debated, like, What do I say? Do I write back and acknowledge it? Do I not write back? Oh, because he made a comment about it, and I didn't say anything. And then he sent me a message saying, you cannot say anything if you want. You can ignore me all you want, even though we used to work together and I worked really hard with you or for you.
Wow.
Yeah, but he hit me with the drop the mask stuff. It's lame.
And he didn't say anything, and he still had to rub it in.
Yeah. He circled the wagons back. And so...
You're thinking we're never talking about this, but next time I see you, we're talking about this.
Yeah, he forced it. I mean, I haven't seen him in probably 12 years. So I decided to write back and just not acknowledge it. Like, hey, man, good to hear from you. I hope you're well.
Come on, you didn't.
Yeah.
And then what?
Well, I feel like there's a message in the not mentioning it, don't you?
No, I know, but did you send a note back yet, or are you gonna?
No, I did.
What happened?
Nothing.
Oh, he didn't reply?
No.
He'd had it. He's like, until you, it's not like, repent your mafkism.
Well, this was the, all right, I'm going to open it up. I'm going to read it to you.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
Because it's a weird one. I mean, we don't really talk a lot.
This is an old bud?
By the way, I couldn't stand TPB and its constant obscenity. Why don't you give the mask stuff a rest? It's only funny to morons.
No, and you didn't say anything? And then all of a sudden he's like, don't say.
Yeah, like give that mask stuff a rest, will you? Because I thought it's kind of funny, like, shout out to the Math with two sets of sunglasses on his head. Like, everybody knows that Math. And he wrote, oh, this is what he wrote originally. The Math stuff is lame. Find a new shtick, bro.
Oh, man.
And that was, like, public. And then I didn't acknowledge it. And then got the, I guess what I should have done is write, yeah, you're absolutely right. Immediately, I will stop. But it makes me laugh. Mask. What other masks were in 73?
You should just send him the Urban Dictionary snapshot of it.
As a mic drop? Can you imagine? And all I say is, mic drop, bro. Do you know what I've been...
Canadianity 73.
Good one.
Terry Jacks.
Seasons in the Sun.
What?
Seasons in the Sun, right?
Yeah.
You gotta let it ride.
You let it ride.
Doomsh. 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 I like to ride a horse to this song.
Yeah. The maid. If you ever go on YouTube,
we had seen
this. You'll find the song, but it's always along with like some photos of somebody who passed away.
Aww.
Every time.
Aw, people make a montage.
Yeah, and then put it on YouTube, and it's just like some poor old bod having a beer with those Wheels Dad glasses on the couch.
We miss you, Uncle Kenny. '80s. Aww.
Stubby beer bottle.
A Horse with No Name was 1971.
Yeah.
We bunny hopped right over that map.
Yeah, we don't get all the jams, but we get...
No, I guess.
We try to get...
I guess.
Hey, you missed one in 68. How come there's no Hendrix?
It's only 10 years till I get to take over.
No.
Like 83, 84? That's going to be the
Why
masks.
Not 80, 81? You feel
I guess.
Like
it's a little early for me. I was just coming into it. Do you know what I can't stop thinking about?
What?
You know the East Coast girl from 72?
Yeah.
The girl last week who lives up in Toronto?
Maybe it's Maybelline over there, girl.
Yeah, oh, frickin' maybe it's Maybelline over there. Carol and I have been talking like that for days, and I want to pitch a sitcom called Andrea and Them. And it's just about Andrea and her friends.
Yeah.
Do you want to hear how lame she can make the six sound?
Yes.
You say, Andrea, where are you living these days?
What?
You say, Andrea, where are you living these days? Okay.
Andrea, where are you living these days?
I can't even say it. I'm up in six.
No.
How uncool does the six sound?
No. Let me do it again, okay?
Okay.
Andrea, where are you living these days?
I'm up in the six. I'm living in the six. Working for Purelators. They gave me a transfer. I need to find something to wear to Carabanas. She's living in Mississauga. It's a sitcom called Andrea and Them. And you can play her roommate that she found on Kijiji's. She puts S's on the end of everything. Purelators gave me a transfer up to Mississauga's.
They became friends after she bought some Rick Astley albums on Kijiji.
Yeah. I found it hard to get my hands on Rick albums, and he was looking for a roomie, so here we are. And she's always trying to find just the right thing to wear to different social outings. Lend me them pants so I can go to Carabanas. All my freaking pants I'd wear if I had yours.
So I can go to Carabana? Lend me them pants.
Lend me them stirrup pants so I can go to Carabanas. My God, things I'd wear if I had your arse. Honest to God, she's a big bone gal, but she doesn't feel bad for herself at all.
No, she's got some like line about how it's her bed. It's my bed, I made it, I know. That's what she goes into.
And she has a magnet on the fridge that says, Lord, save me from snacking. But she feels really good about, like, she can eat Viva Puffs on the couch and look at her friend and say, oh, my frig, you parading around at my goal weight? I love Andrea and Them so much.
Andrea and Them.
Next time on Andrea and Them. What the frig am I going to wear to the Molson Amphitheater?
Big narration.
Styx is coming to the Molson Amphitheater. What the frig am I going to wear? Do you have any tank tops that might fit me? I remember last November I moved to Toronto and I got on a call and I started to go to the Molson Amphitheater and that's when we came and I got out of the cab hall.
She's a parrot head too for Jimmy Buffett.
Yeah, for sure.
She reads his books. She's like, shut up, I'm reading my book, Jimmy Buffett novels.
Ask Andrea what she does for a living.
Hey, Andrea, what do you do again for a living?
Right now I'm in accounts payable at Purelators, but I'm thinking of driving an Ubers.
She's got like a bag of chips in the Uber. She hands it back like it's all open.
One of the things I do on my Ubers is I have little Halloween treats. And people can help themselves like a little box of Smarties with them tiny chips.
Let me get you guys some chips. She has a little bowl and she grabs with her hands.
Do you just want a Big 8 for the drive? She gives out cans Big 8.
What?
Is Big 8 an East Coast thing? It's like a no-name brand soda.
I've never heard of that.
Do you want a Big 8 soda water?
Do you want a Big 8?
And she has a VCR in the back and a collection of movies, and you can pop in a movie if you want. That's what she got in her Ubers.
She's been playing the Breakfast Club over and over.
Yeah. You can watch St. Elmo's Fire, or if you really like Demi Moore, you can watch About Last Night.
What happened to Emilio Estevez, eh?
I never see him around anymore. The arse on him. Like it was sculpted by angels. Andrea and Them. What happened to Andrea and Them? They live up in the six. They moved up to the six. I guess technically they live in the five, don't they?
For sure. There's no way.
I live in a five.
I live in north of Vaughn.
Andrea got a roommate in the five. She met him on Kijiji's. His name is Sean.
The nine. The 289.
What's the 289?
That's like the like if you just got here and you get a new phone.
Next time on Andrea and Them. I got a date in that revolving restaurant at the top of the CN Tower. Lend me your pants, will you?
The 360. Yeah. She's all banged up. It's like, get me out of here. Can't deal
with it. I'm gonna freaking take a selfie on top of the CN Tower the way Drake Dawn.
She's all complaining at dinner that she's getting nauseous from the spinning.
It's spinning 1 mile an hour. Holy friggin', never been up this high in my life. That includes being in an airplane. My Uncle Spider had a 4-passenger Piper Saratoga in him, and he never went this high up.
That's her at the table with the big dress on.
Say next time on Andrea and them.
Next time on Andrea and them.
Are you going to finish that roll? She's on a date from Plenty of Fishes, because that Tinder stuff, all they want to do is bang you. They don't even buy you soup. Just come over and wash my bird and be gone with you.
Okay. She's going to Vaughn Mills on the Tinder.
Yeah. Give me one more next time on Andrea and them.
Okay. Next time on Andrea and them.
Have you seen my yoga pants in the dryer?
The Lulu Lemonies?
Yeah. My Lulu Lemons were in the dryer when I left. There's only 3 units in the building. One of you has seen them. I feel like I can see Andrea, and I think it's the character that I've been dying to play my whole life.
I know. It's so good. That never gets old.
But you as the, you're the roommate who needs the money, but Andrea's maybe not someone you would have chosen as a roommate. But maybe you're so studly that you've gotten into trouble in the past with having either dude roommates because you wheel their girlfriends or really attractive girl roommates because you can't not keep it physical. So this was your strategy. You're going to get someone like Andrea because you're like, well, we're just buds. Never any weirdness. What is your name?
The roommate?
Yeah.
Laramie?
Laramie. Like the Dodge truck?
Yeah.
Dear Diary, he says his name's friggin' Laramie. I don't know if that's a typo or some kind of city name, but I never heard of it in my life. The weird thing is, his waist is smaller than mine. He could borrow my pants if he wanted to. Dude, he's got an arse on him the size of a sea monkey.
To the yell from the kid from the couch to the kitchen to Laramie.
Laramie, if you got any eggs left, I'll pay you back.
Here's another 73 jam.
Is this Laramie practicing bass in his room?
Practicing bass or yeah. Clavinet? Ian Thomas. He's a bod.
Good jam. Yeah, he is.
You ever meet Ian Thomas?
I have.
What's that?
I have.
Isn't he a beauty?
He's amazing.
He's a great dude.
He's so great. I mean, we were on one of these Zosky trips up to Northern Canada together. And you go to some of these smaller communities, and they don't necessarily have the gear that these guys would be used to, or the concert maybe hasn't been advertised. He's like, all right, no problem. Let's get it going. Like, totally gets it. Really nice. Cool dude. And funny, too.
Really funny. You can tell it's Dave Thomas, his brother. He might be even more funny than Dave.
Is that true? I didn't even know they were brothers.
Yeah. That's where Bob and Doug came from, them.
Wow.
They used to do the Hosers growing up.
And I didn't know that at all.
Yeah, yeah.
That's a why great jam.
In the SCTV episode where Ian Thomas comes and plays that club, he's hanging out with Bob and Doug, and he totally starts doing the Hoser, and that's where it kind of came from.
Wow.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yep.
Painted Ladies was a good Ian Thomas jam. So was Right Before Your Eyes.
Yeah.
Remember?
Mm-hmm.
That's Every Day I Sit Beside You on the Bus to Madison Avenue.
Yeah, that's a great
jam. Let's let Painted Ladies take us to break.
Okay,
on
perfect.
Andrea and them.
Let's do it.
Laramie? Where are my nerds at? Laramie, turn that down for a sec. Have you seen my nerds? I had one of the two packs, orange on one side, purple on the other. Laramie, where are my nerds? Fricker can't even hear me.
Where's my beer chair?
Danny go. That was 73, huh?
Yep. Somebody sent a picture of Anne Murray on the darts.
Like 70s darts or recent darts?
Yeah, like an old set picture with her and like Stompin' Tom. So that's for sure.
Written by...
Nobody's not on the darts from our original episode of On the Darts.
I love that people are like making it a mission to find out, like, is Luba on the darts? Kenny Loggins wrote that song.
Is there... There's nobody from that original episode that's not on the darts.
I think Luba was the only one who's apparently not on the darts.
Luba?
Yeah. I almost tweeted Brian Adams yesterday to ask.
Back in the day, no, but someone sent in, I don't know if it was a tweet or an email, that their...
Yeah, their aunt, like, confirmed aunt he was on the darts in high school.
Yeah, so there you go. That's even better.
Why smoking is it so fun?
I don't know. And now there's the Twitter feed on the darts. Someone started it. It's not us. But we appreciate it.
It is oddly compelling.
It really is. How about this? Remember the hit from last week was the Joey Kramer dive-in song.
Great story.
The dive-in jam. So we're going to put this 73 jam on. Someone should document that story with that and put Dream On in the background.
Didn't you see? Someone sent us a message that said it happened in their town.
Yes, somebody from Massachusetts, like, out, it's, I think, a borough of Boston, but somebody said, yeah, I know that story well, and so that's been confirmed as a classic tale. It did catch on fire, and he did dive, and the cop did say that.
I can't think of a time this year that I've laughed harder than that.
I think that we need to hear that story with this song in the background.
Like he's lighting the dart. Someone should make a short film.
Yeah, short film with this song.
But it starts with, oh, I should get some gas. Like, so innocuous.
He walks in and gets the dart. It's filling the tank. It's all full. And then he lights a dart right here. And then it shows the fire going down into the tank and then explodes now.
Maybe like everything of that time, it starts with him on a payphone saying, I'll be right at the studio, fellas. I'm just going to get some gas.
I just want to top it up before because I hate driving home at night with an empty tank.
I like that you're giving him this much backstory. I'm just going to grab a sub... And I'm going to get a tank of gas, and then I'll be over to the studio.
The microwave sub?
Yeah. Did they have microwaves in the... I guess they did in the 80s.
Yeah, it's late 80s, I think.
He probably even had a car phone.
Yeah, oh, for sure.
I had a car phone in the late 80s.
And then they show the explosion again here in the video. The dive... There's a big fire and then like people in the neighborhood all upset.
Or what if he's in the ambulance thrashing around fitfully and he keeps flashing back to the explosion? And the woman in the ambulance, her name's Andrea, and she's like, are you all right?
He's like... I'm fine, but he's got like burns in his hair.
Yeah. I'm just on my work term. I'm here from Glace Bay.
He's like, is my car okay?
Oh, there's not much left of it. We swept it up and carried it with us in a Sobeys bag, but I don't think it's going to get you home.
I gotta get to practice, right?
And the gurney, when the drum kicks in, the gurney is going through the emergency room doors.
They're doing like the cutting open his jeans.
Yeah.
He's like, man, you know what these cost?
They're Jordache. Don't cut them. Sir, we're going to have to cut your tank top. It's my favorite one.
He's fine. And he's like leaving it in one of those ropes with no, because all his clothes are cut off him.
And he has a band of white tape, like a headband, around his hair. And it's just holding the pieces that were singed off in place. It's like a tape wig.
And what's the first thing he does when he gets out of the hospital?
Has a dart. Yeah. He's out on the sidewalk having a dart in his Johnny shirt when the band comes to visit.
Open back with a thong.
It's like as dramatic as riding on the bus with my sister. Like, he has to sit down with the doctor. Like, you probably don't remember what happened. I know exactly what happened. Your memory is probably playing tricks on you. I know what happened. Irritability is part of this stage. It's okay.
Going through the trauma.
He's in group therapy for other singed, dark smoking gassers.
He's like, but I'm fine.
No, you're not fine. How on earth is he still with us?
I don't know.
Is he still with us?
Yeah, of course. John Joey Kramer, yeah. He's 100% still with us. Oh, oh, man.
Joey Kramer on the darts.
How about this 73 jam? Stir It Up.
Yeah.
Catch a Fire album with the Wailers.
That's earlier than I would have pegged them, too. It's a great jam.
Oh, man. And then, like, later that year, they put out another album with, like, Get Up, Stand Up, and all those jams.
Hey, you know when the Jays get on bass and they do the little Stir It Up thing?
Yeah.
Is that from this song?
Probably. I don't know.
Like, I don't know if Stir It Up as an expression otherwise, do you?
Stir it up, stirring it up. Other than, like, starting a problem.
Yeah.
Starting a dust up.
Little dust up. It's a good jam, man. You haven't picked every song in 73, though.
Not every one. But how about this Allman Brothers Jessica jam? Here's your driving jam. You're trying a new wig out and on the country roads.
This is Joey Kramer's back behind the wheel.
Yeah, and he's like trying a new, driving fast to try new hair. Make sure it stays. Can it handle the back roads of Massachusetts? In my Rosa.
He probably had them drop off a new car at the hospital.
Brand new one?
Yeah.
To pick him up with no pants on. throws the blue robe thing on the ground and then just goes in the car underwear. bare ass.
Yeah. Sticking fresh, to the leather seats.
Fresh Rosa.
Gross.
Throws out a, hey, heated seats before he leaves.
Ugh. How'd he get home? He bare-arsed at home from the hospital.
What jam does he have playing? This?
It's pretty good. Out?
Little Twain Allman rocking home.
If he was taking the PCH up to Malibu, this is a good jam for him to have playing.
Or to get he's got to go down to Providence to meet a buddy from Mass. That rip down the highway is to New York City.
He's looking to score.
Yeah.
He's probably going to 7-Eleven to get a carton of darts.
They got this great junk in Long Island.
What if in the passenger seat there's a carton of Marlboro Reds that's strapped in with a seatbelt?
Yeah.
Road darts.
It's named.
Let's take a little break on TNT 73, and we'll be back with a quick game.
Ooh, a quick game. How about this jam will take us out?
Come back, will ya?
There's a voice. Keeps on calling me.
We're playing a new game.
Hobo or Nobo?
Hobo or Nobo?
I'll make a new plan. I'm going to read you the plot of an episode of The Littlest Hobo. And you have to tell me if it was a real one, Hobo, or a fake one, Nobo.
I love that. It's Hobo or Nobo.
Might as well ride it out.
Yeah, it's almost over here.
That's Hobo style.
Dog. If I saw a dog running through a field with a rifle in its mouth, I don't know if I'd be petting it. Or like, hey, buddy.
Was London on the darts, the dog that paid the littlest hobo?
No, but like its trainer was. Its trainer was on heavy darts, so it reeked like darts all around.
Because London had to ride in the car. It reeked like
in the
darts.
Back seat. Oh, remember that? The old days of the. I still see that sometimes. Like someone with their windows up crushing the dart.
I know. It's shocking. It's as shocking as when you see someone chuck litter out the window of a moving car.
Totally.
That brings out the. Well, I never.
Yeah,
in
no
me.
Kidding.
I was walking with my mom the other day, and this guy was on a 10 speed, and he finished crushing a Labatt's. And like, blah, scorched and chucked it in the parking lot. I was like, where am I? 1970?
Yeah.
It was the crush, burp, and chuck.
Oh,
blah,
greasy.
Car scorch.
No way, like Barney from The Simpsons.
Yeah. Yeah, it was exactly like a shirtless, tattooed, maybe on crack Barney from The Simpsons.
Fuck that guy. So
okay,
let's play.
Hobo or Nobo?
Okay.
I'll give you the plot. You tell me if it was a real one or a fake one. Hobo helps rescue a prima ballerina who wants to defect from her Iron Curtain captors.
Iron Curtain captors? Really? They're like, get in the car! Like that? Yeah. That's a hobo.
That's a hobo. You're right.
Yeah.
Hobo protects an elderly prospector from greedy land grabbers.
To be honest, I think I've seen that one, Hobo.
Yeah, that's Hobo. I feel like it's every episode. Yeah. Hey, what do you want, little fella? You're an awful cute dog. What do you want with an old stinker like me?
Every time, yeah. Or some kid who was just beat up by a bunch of kids.
Oh, my hat's in the river. Okay, you're 2 for 2.
And then it, like, leads the guy to gold? The prospector?
Yeah. Where's my hat? It's like, Smucker's Jam!
What about your percentage, boy? And he's walking away already.
Aww.
Yeah, every time.
He's gonna deal him in?
Yeah, for sure.
Gold about a lot of kibble.
He's already fucked off by the time he's, like, turned around, like, way down the hill.
What about your boy?
He's like Wheel's dad, the original. The littlest hobo is always
gone.
On, always.
Hobo rescues a politician's son from kidnappers.
That sounds so hobo. Hobo.
Correct.
Yes.
Okay, this one is tricky.
Okay.
There's a lot of kidnapping in that era.
Yeah, always.
Hobo helps rescue two kidnapped victims and in the process recovers $1 million worth of stolen furs.
That's so Canadian, though, and if you wanted to throw that script, that might be a Gemini winner. I'm going to say Hobo.
That's Hobo.
Yes, I knew it. Yeah. That's awesome.
Hobo,
illegal fur trade going on.
Hobo helps an innocent man wrongfully accused of murder.
What? No way. What, like he finds some rusty knife with DNA on it?
Escape the clutches of a sheriff and his bloodhounds.
He's like, woof, woof. And he's got a big camera in his mouth, like a tape.
He's got a plastic Ziploc bag that he's dropping the knife into very carefully.
Yeah. He comes with an Adidas bag and it's got like 7 different items to frame somebody else.
Hobo helps an innocent man wrongfully accused of murder escape the clutches of a sheriff and his bloodhounds.
Come on, that sounds like a Nobo.
That's Hobo, bud.
No, it really happened. Yeah. Think...
That's a real one.
A sheriff.
Hobo befriends a down-and-out ex-vaudevillian who has been shoplifting with every intent to pay it back when she becomes a star again.
That sounds like a modern Hobo trying to compete with the drama twists of the 80s. Hobo.
Hobo, correct.
Oh my god, that's crazy.
Ex-vaudevillian.
Ex-vaudevillian, so it's like, it's doing these miming.
Yeah.
And the dog's like, what if salad? Like, let's get some shit done here.
Everyone's so down and out.
Yeah.
Hobo travels with Willie, a tramp, and Kate, a runaway little girl.
Yikes.
Who are hitchhiking across the country to California, where they plan to open up an orange juice stand.
Whoa. The hobos, like, talked her into this business?
A hobo, a tramp, and a girl are hitchhiking to California to open an orange juice stand.
That's so screwed up, I gotta say Hobo.
That's Hobo.
No way! I love how they don't use Canada in the show.
Well, and you couldn't have a man and a girl hitchhiking to California nowadays, I don't think.
No. Oh, sneeze.
I wonder if they were going to open an Orange Julius.
That would be it. That's why
they were smuggling butterfly laughter across the border.
In the 80s.
Hobo mans a disco control panel and helps the victim of an underworld frame-up.
No way. No chance. That's a Nobo for sure.
That's a Hobo.
No, it's not.
Yeah, it is.
What's with how crazy that one is? Say that again.
Hobo mans a disco control panel and helps the victim of an underworld frame-up. Okay, there's 3 left.
He runs a disco light show?
Yeah.
That's really reaching. That's got to be like late episode.
Do you know what I really admired, though, about the actors on Hobo? Because in the case of the tramp and the girl, they could at least talk to each other. But in the person that is confronted with Hobo has to do a lot of heavy lifting in the, what's that, boy? What?
Oh, for sure.
You want to help me? Why?
Yeah.
Like, Robert De Niro would have a hard time selling that.
And the dog would always just look at them the same way every single time.
A struggling artist considers an illegal sale to clear mafia debts.
Hobo. Let's go for
Hobo,
it.
Hobo, correct.
Come on. So there was no Nobos.
So far, there's still 2 left.
Oh, there's 2 left.
Hobo aids a captain whose crew mutinied and stole pearls.
No way. That sounds like a too big budget Nobo.
That's a Hobo, Bob.
Oh, my God. with special guest star Alan Hale.
Listen to this one.
Okay.
Hobo arrives in a small country town hit by forest fire where he helps rescue animals from the blaze and befriends forest ranger Ray Caldwell.
That sounds so Hobo.
The local storekeeper, much to Ray's disgust, has started selling animal traps and poison to ward off the now homeless animals coming near the town. When a child eats poisoned meat left outside the store and a thunderstorm prevents Ray from bringing the local doctor in by plane, Hobo is parachuted into the town with the antidote needed to save the child's life. Hobo or Nobo?
That sounds like the last episode of Hobo, like where they're shutting it down and this can't, like they're like,
guess what that was?
Right?
That was the first episode of Hobo.
No, it was not.
Because if you go on Wikipedia, the write-ups for the episodes get decidedly shorter after that one.
Oh, really?
Hobo encourages a paraplegic boy to enter a frisbee-throwing contest to the dismay of the youth's overly protective widowed father, who hates dogs because his driving at excessive speed and swerving to avoid a stray dog led to the car crash which killed his wife and left his son paralyzed. When Hobo saves the boy's life, the father finally sees the light. This episode also featured a young Mike Myers as the paralyzed boy's friend, Tommy.
Unbelievable. Okay, that's it. That's Hobo, and here, look.
Such a great jam. Hey, can I tell you one thing?
It's the entrance exit. Yeah.
Harry, a night watchman at an electronics firm, and his German Shepherd Sage are framed for the theft of top secret equipment, featuring actor Alan Hale, skipper from Gilligan's Island.
No way.
Good chatting, bud.
Wow, bud. Boom, gang, 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 gang